161, we'll sing the stanzas 1 and 3, if you will. 1 and 3.
to be a Rhodes, to have come through the lineage of Essex and Laverne Johnson Rhodes. And so we are grateful just to be here today and to have the opportunity as a family to worship together in a place and in a way that is not sad, but that is joyful, that is celebratory. And so we're grateful for the opportunity that we have today. So after, I believe, would that be a selection? Or is he?
No, sir.
After I finish then, the voice that you will hear will be that of my father and the pastor of the Trinidad Baptist Church in Northeast Washington, D.C., son of Essex and Laverne Johnson Rhodes, the Reverend Dr. John Thomas Rhodes Sr.
Amen.
Will come and break for us the bread of life. Receive him with your amens.
Amen.
Amen.
We honor the Lord today to Pastor Hawkins and to the Canaan family, to my family and all who are present today. It is just good to be here in this place once again.
Amen.
God has done so many wonderful things for all of us, and not the least of which is allowed us to gather as a family and as a community of friends and the family again once here at the Upper Canaan Church. And I am grateful, as I expressed Pastor Hawkins when I spoke to them earlier, the opportunity to come and share with you in this worship time. And I am grateful for all of the wonderful things that we have experienced this weekend. I'm delighted to see so many of you who have come to share this worship time with us, going all the way back to grade school, elementary school, friends, high school graduates, and all of those who were with us as we came up in the community called Woodstock. I could not let this moment pass without just acknowledging one very special gentleman who impacted my life in a great, great way. When people talk about working, I said, well, I've had a social security number and a job since age 13. All of that was in large part due to Dr. Fred Johnson. Dr. Johnson supervised the custodial young men who worked and served custodial works at Woodstock High School. And for all of that, I am indeed grateful. Teaching a great and strong work ethic, one of the things that I think of my classmates will remember Dr. Johnson having said was that hard times will make a monkey eat red peppers. I remember that. Sharing of his, and so I didn't want to be the monkey that ate red peppers, so I tried my very best to do what God would allow me to do and work in the kingdom. Today I want to be brief with what I share with you and call your attention to a portion of the scripture that we are all familiar with. The gospel is recorded by Luke in chapter number 12, beginning at verse 22 and concluding the reading at verse 34. And if you will permit me, I am reading from the New King James Version of Scripture today. Read this into our hearing and share a word with us from this passage today. The rest of the pages, turn there. Luke chapter 12, beginning at verse 22. Then he said to his disciples, therefore I say to you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat, nor about the body, what you will put on. Life is more than food, and the body is more than clothing. Consider the ravens, for they neither sow nor reap, which have neither storehouse nor barn, and God feeds them. Of how much more value are you than the birds? Which of you, by worrying, can add one cubit to his stature? You then are not able to do the least. Why are you anxious for the rest? Consider the lilies, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. And yet I say to you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. If then God so clothes the grass, which today is in the field and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, how much more will he clothe you, O you of little faith? and do not seek what you should eat, what you should drink, nor have an anxious mind. For all these things the nations of the world seek after, and your Father knows you need them. But seek the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added to you. Do not fear, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give to you the kingdom. Sell what you have and give alms. Provide yourselves money bags which do not grow old, a treasure in the heavens that does not fail, where no thief approaches nor moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And so ends the reading from the gospel recorded by Luke chapter 12, verses 22 through verse 34. I want to title the message today, In Search of the Good Life. You may ask yourself the question, what is this good life that I speak of? There's hardly a person, I believe, in the room today who has not dreamed for and longed for what someone calls the good life. We usually characterize it by ease and lack of any want for anything. The good life says that after a long and productive career, a time has come that perhaps we will be able to retire, do some traveling, do whatever it is that we enjoy most, fish all day if that's what we want to do. But whatever it is, it characterizes for us a desire for a future time when we will be able to enjoy life because we will have invested much in preparation. Much effort is put into securing this, and I call it a very elusive goal, but some have gone so far as to calculate far in advance the dollar amount that would be necessary to afford them the measure of comfort they desire. I dare to say that any who have arrived there would probably say, well, I didn't calculate well enough, because there's still some other things that I'd like to do, but I am not in a position to do them as I would. But I am grateful today that God tells us that we can enjoy the good life, not somewhere way in the future, but we can enjoy a good life here and now.
Right.
Many neglect the present in order to bankroll a future that is uncertain, or they are often found worrying over matters that are beyond their control. A lot of economic distresses are around us in our times. It is hard oftentimes even for believers not to become concerned about the conditions surrounding life. We worry about world peace. We have our family from California, and I know that our friends and our family from California are greatly concerned about the worst drought in years. And then there are some of us who are fretting what is happening to our ecosystems, and we are concerned about global warming. And many others are anxious about jobs and health care and retirement and all sorts of other things that could be added to a long list of concerns that trouble us day by day. But in today's text, Jesus tells us not to be anxious about tomorrow, not to be overly concerned about material things that for our Heavenly Father knows that our needs, what our needs are, and He has everything under control. And I'm glad about that. I'm glad that even though we have seen our president have some victories with the Affordable Care Act, where the Congress has been after him for over 50 some odd attempts to derail it, to cast it aside. He's prevailed in the courts again and said, this looks as if this will be a lasting legacy for one of the things that he has been able to accomplish. And yes, while we are concerned about the economy, while we're concerned about health care for all men, we find ourselves sometimes as overly concerned about wealth and its acquisition as those who are already sitting in major comfort and ease. It's not only the wealthy who have become concerned, but we ourselves. When we think about what surrounds this passage in Scripture, we discover in the verses just before the portion I read into your hearing that Jesus has addressed his disciples and others who have heard his conversation with a man who wanted him to arbitrate between him and his brother. The man said to Jesus, "Tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." And thereupon Jesus spoke the parable of the rich fool. And the story goes that there was a man whose ground brought forth bountifully, and he determined that because of the great increase, he would tear down the storehouses and he would build other storehouses. And then when it was done, he would say, "I will say to my soul, take thine ease, for you have much laid up in store." And Jesus says that the unfortunate thing about this man's foolishness is that he did not know that on this very evening his soul would be required. That's a bit of gross arrogance in this man's speaking to. He says, "When I have amassed it, I will say, as I look about, look what I have amassed, look what I have accumulated, and then I will say to my soul, take thine ease." The foolish thing about it is that he is not the one who has made the ground produce. But he is not the one who has made his barns bulge. He did not go and labor and bring in the harvest. There were countless others in his employ. And so oftentimes we want to dismiss, as have some others, to whom our president has spoken in past times as well. You did not do this by yourself. Wherever you are, whoever you are, and whatever station in life you presently occupy, you did not get there on your own. You did not get there by yourself. And so this man's foolishness was to attribute to himself the kind of ability that only God is able to provide. Only God makes the sun shine, and only God sends the rain. Or in this case, only God withholds the rain. God is the one who made the ground fertile, and it brought forth abundantly. Oh, yes, he says, "I will tear these barns down, build bigger and bigger barns," foolishly concluding that because he had much material substance, that he could now enjoy the good life. I'll say to my soul, "Thou hast much goods laid up for many years." But how many of us in the room today know that mortal man is unable to declare with certainty what tomorrow will hold? If you had a magic mirror to look into and you could see down the road, I don't believe that you would want to know the kinds of things that wait for us further down the way. Because it is certain that if we do not, as a nation, do something about our drifting away from the values that have been so true and anchored us in the past, we will find ourselves in a moral dilemma, unable to find our way out. I don't know what tomorrow is going to hold, but I do know that there is one who holds tomorrow. When I think about the confidence that we had years ago in the stock market, only to see it collapse in 2008, and thank God, while there are those who are in a majority position in the Congress in Washington who declare that our president hasn't done anything, he brought the stock market back to the greatest position it has ever known. And yet they claim that he hasn't done anything. When Bear Stearns and AIG and Lehman Brothers had taken us over the cliff, who was it that inherited it and brought us back to a place of soundness? And yet, there is no credit given unto him. Jesus calls the man who went there and tore those barns down. He calls his behavior foolish. Thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. And then who shall those things be that thou hast provided? And so it is, Jesus says, for him that layeth up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. You cannot save for the future and ignore God in this present moment. Amen. The rich farmer worried because he had too much. But the disciples, as you and I, might be tempted to worry because it seems that we don't have enough. The disciples had given up all that they had in order to follow Jesus. And they were living by faith, and faith is always tested. Worry then becomes very deceptive, for it gives us a false view of life and of God. It convinces us that life is about getting all you can and canning all you get and then sitting back to enjoy it. But worry, you see, blinds us to the way that God cares for his creation. I'm going to leave about 3 points with you and then I'm going to take my seat. We must first of all recognize that worry or anxiety is foolish, because number one, nature demonstrates that God has concern for man, who is his crowning jewel in creation. Listen to him when he says in Matthew, "Behold, the fowl of the air. You are worth more than many sparrows." But here Jesus speaks about the raven. The raven, even the unclean scavenger bird. God takes care of even the raven and assures it that it will not die for lack. The lilies of the field are dressed up with great splendor, even more so than Solomon. I enjoy riding along the highways and seeing in between the roadways wildflowers with their beauty just spreading all over the place. Wonderful colors and wonderful hues there say that God is still in control of what is going on. Right there in the median, God has put an island of beauty in the midst of concrete. And who would not love and worship a God like that? Who wants us to see the beauty of his creation all around us? When I am in the air and I'm flying, I can't help but enjoy the beauty of God's handiwork, flying over the Grand Canyon, flying over the snow-capped Rocky Mountains, looking at the winding rivers. I see God at work, and I see him working so that I might have a sense of who he is. Yes, worry can't change anything, brothers and sisters. In verses 25 to 28, the word says you cannot add a cubit. Now, a cubit is 18 inches. And surely now, if I could have done something, I would have grown as tall as my brothers or taller. The word says you can't add one cubit to your height. It may be better understood like this. You can't even add 1 minute or 1 hour to your life. And if you can't do what is least, why concern yourself with what is greater? Brothers and sisters, today I need to let you know that when you're looking for the good life, don't overlook a relationship with God. When you're searching for the good life, don't let it all boil down to dollars and cents and the amount that you have deposited in your 401k. I wouldn't even say in a savings account, but it ain't paying anything these days. So you ought not take very much comfort in those kinds of things at all. But there is a God who sits on his throne in heaven, and he will stretch out your social security. Things you can't change. And don't worry about them, because you can't add a minute, not even 1 second, to your life. But remember this, God gives to us freely, and he knows what it is that you stand in need of. And I'm so thankful about that, because when he says to us, do not seek what you should eat or what you should drink, nor have an anxious mind. For all these things the nations of the world seek after, and your Father knows that you need these things. And the distinction here is when he says the nations of the world, even people who are not saved have these kinds of concerns. People who are destined for hell are concerned about what to wear and what to eat and what the future is going to hold. But because you belong to the Lord Jesus Christ, you ought to have a confidence. You ought to have a trust in him. You ought to believe that because I have believed on him and I have trusted him, he's going to take care of me. I wasn't that smart. I wasn't that smart growing up, but I have discovered that God will take care of you. If you give to him what he requires, he'll take care of you. I've shared this, and I probably shared it when we were here at Revival at some time. Our two oldest graduated from high school 2 years apart, and we did not have money to send them off to college. And so I heard the Lord saying as clear as day, if you take care of my business, I'll take care of your business. And so I had two in college at the same time. And only thing that I had to be concerned about was room and board, for one. And the other had a full 5-year scholarship. And I hear God still saying over and over and over again, if you'll take care of my business, I'll take care of your business. If you'll trust in me to provide for what you need, I won't disappoint you. I can't let him down. I won't let him down. He's done too much for me. Because he's done so much for me. All these things, the nations, the heathens, the Gentiles, the unsaved people in the world, seek after these things, and your Father in heaven knows what your needs are. But seek ye first the kingdom, and all these things shall be added to you. There ought to be some witnesses in the room. Just trust in him and you do what he's calling you to do. He will not disappoint. He will take care of you. He says he freely gives us all these things. And then this last thing I need to share with you is that there's a time for introspection when we come to the end of this text. Because he says, do not fear, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give to you the kingdom. Now, listen, it sounds very strange. Sell what you have and give alms. Provide yourselves money bags which do not grow old, a treasure in the heavens that does not fail, where no thief approaches nor moth destroys. But here he says, examine your heart, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Some of us have wrapped up our hearts. Our hearts are wrapped up in the possessions that we have. And when something happens to the possessions that are ours to be stewards over for just a brief while, we become disturbed and upset with God when they are touched or somehow another blown upon and wither or evaporate. But thanks be unto God that wherever you invest, wherever your heart is, rather, that's where your treasure will be. Where your treasure is, that's where your heart will be. You can't tell me that you love God, but you are not generous towards God. You cannot say that you love Upper Canaan Church and you do not support Upper Canaan Church. You can't say that you love your wife, your spouse, your children, and do not provide for them. Wherever your treasure is, your heart will be there also.
Yes.
And I can tell you right now, just let me see your checkbook and I can tell you where your treasure is and where your heart is. Amen. If I look and see that you're paying out more to Visa and MasterCard than you give in the Lord's work, I know where your treasure is. I know where your heart is. If you're riding large, but giving nothing, I know where your treasure is. I know where your heart is. And wherever your treasure is, your heart will be there also. Well, I'm still looking. I'm still looking. I think I've stumbled onto the secret of the good life. The good life is obeying Him in all of the things that He puts before me to do. The good life can be summarized as, in the words that Jesus Himself has left in this text, of seeking the kingdom and the righteousness of God. And all of these things that are so weighty and so much concern for others will be added unto you likewise. I know today that as we come to this place of worship as a family, there are young folk here, and I don't know when I'll have an opportunity to speak to all my nieces and nephews and all of you again in this kind of way, but I can assure you that the things that your grandfather, your grandmother, your fathers, and other relatives are enjoying today are the consequence of trusting that God can be trusted. Yes. Amen. Yes. Believing that God can be trusted. Amen. You can count on Him.
All right.
You can't count on a whole lot of other stuff that's going on in the world around you. But you can count on God.
Amen.
God did not disappoint Essex Rhodes and Laverne Johnson Rhodes. And we're so thankful for the Johnson part of our family, Morgan Johnson, here with us today. We understand that God has chosen His people, has called His people to places of favor and blessing because they will obey Him and do what He has commanded them to do. Once again, let me just simply admonish you. As you are looking towards the future, and as you are hopeful of seeing your children grow and mature and become successful, however that is defined, don't forget that an important element of this whole process is a personal relationship with God.
Amen.
We enjoy the heritage, but it's like this: God does not have grandchildren. That means simply that what mama and daddy had, it was mama and daddy. Their relationship with the Lord, it was personal.
Yeah,
and you can't make it in on granddaddy's prayer, on granddaddy's coattails, or anything like that. You got to have this relationship yourself. And if you go for to establish with your families the kind of relationships that you see modeled before you by those who sleep with the Lord today, you will enjoy the good life. Mm-hmm. A good life. I didn't say you're going to have wealth. I said you'd enjoy the good life.
Amen.
And the good life is always one comfort with security and knowing that God will take care of you each and every day, all along the way. God will take care of you. Be not dismayed, whatever time. God will take care of you. If beneath His wings of love you will abide, God will take care of you. Every day or all the way, He will take care of you. I found the good life. I wouldn't trade it in for $1 billion.